Dreams and bones and bats and bones and teenage monsters and haunted homes. A ghost on the stair, a vampire's bite. There beware, there's a full moon tonight.
Which are just basically one-on-one with an actor deserving to talk about their legacy. And, right now we're going to start with Mr. SID HAIG.
Which was basically, don't make the same mistakes I had. We just had a fantastic experience working with him.
In Spider-Man, you know, you worked with a legend, you played an extremely creepy role, but the two characters that got me in the film were Elizabeth and Virginia Mary. Talk about working with those two actresses and how they were able to pull off such amazing performances is completely insane.
I know, it was great. And Beverly Washburn had been an actress for quite a number of years. She was the little girl in Old Yeller. Yeah. And, you know, she was like 8 years old or something. And she was 23 when we did Spider-Man. And she'd been working all of that time. As a matter of fact, in her biography, her book, she points out the fact that she was the breadwinner in the family. She had the chops. She had been doing this for a long time. Jill Benner, by the way, had never done anything before. She was absolutely amazing. She lied about her age. Okay, she said she was 18. She was actually 17 or 18. And her mother didn't even know that she was doing the film. She thought she was going to school and, you know, doing stuff after school or whatever. Surprise! when the film came out, I guess she got in trouble or whatever. Parents didn't like the idea. But she met a very untimely death. Okay, she was really still in her like early 20s. The thing that was so weird about it was that she got in a car accident. She was driving a black Porsche Spider, exactly like James Dean's black Porsche Spider, and the accident happened almost exactly the same spot as his accident. It was incredible. And at the gravesite, after her funeral, there was one guy standing there, and it was Marlon Brando. He said, "This is probably the only woman that I've really ever loved." Yeah, she's an amazing, amazing girl.
So, you've done a lot of work in your career with another actor named Pam Grier. We've talked to you before about her. You have some great stories. Can you talk about your relationship with Pam and some of the things that you guys have gotten into over the years?
Trouble. Pam is amazing. She's, we're like that. I've done six pictures with her. And she didn't even really want to be an actress. She was working as a receptionist at American International Pictures. And Jack Hill had to go there because he had to meet with the producers. He was trying to do this film in the Philippines called The Big Dollhouse. And he went upstairs and he said, "Who's that girl that's the receptionist?" Okay. "I don't know, she's just some girl." "Well, is she an actress?" You know, because like everybody in Hollywood is an actor. Your plumber is an actor, your gardener is an actor, everybody's an actor. And so he went down and talked to her, and he had to talk her in doing this role. Okay? And so he called me, and the way that I got into that picture was like totally nuts. I was supposed to do a picture in Italy. This was right after Clint Eastwood decided that, you know, he was not going to do any more spaghetti westerns. And Lee Van Cleef was going to take over basically his roles as, you know, and Fistful of Dollars and Fistful of War and High and all that stuff. And I was going to take over Lee Van Cleef's role. Well, the Italian director got nervous because he didn't have an actor that he could reach out and touch, okay? Started production because Van Cleef was already living over there. And so I got fired. And being an international deal, I couldn't, you know, sue him or anything like that. So it was like, shit, I'm out of work. And the next day, Jack called and said, "I'm doing a picture in the Philippines. Do you want to come?" I said, "Hell yes." I found this girl. She's absolutely amazing. He started going on and on and on about her. I said, yeah, okay, great. great, I get it. Okay, let's just do this. So I show up in the Philippines and I take one look and she's absolutely gorgeous. Okay. And we meet. I'm Sid Pam, and I'm Sid, blah, blah, blah. And we do our very first scene. And it's the scene where she's trying to talk me into helping them break out of prison. Okay. And she, and this was in the script, this wasn't like her doing this, but it's in the script. She grabs my hands through the bars and shoves it up her crotch. Hi, how are you? My name's Sid. I'm Pam. Yeah, good. I mean, we had met like 15 minutes before. And now we're doing this crazy scene together. And then we broke for lunch. And that was the most sexually charged room that I've ever been in my life. Nobody talked. Everybody just ate. We didn't look at one another. Okay. And finally, after lunch, Roberta Collins came up to me and she said, you know, there's not going to be a dry pair of pants in the house, okay? That was pretty wild. Then we shot the second scene where I put my hand up her blouse and started massaging her bazooms. So yeah, we became friends, like real quick. But at the same time, we did a lot of pictures in the Philippines together and we always had one another's back. I could always depend on her, and she could depend on me too. So time went by, and Quentin Tarantino called me at my house. I still don't know how he got my number. It's like, you know, when you're Quentin Tarantino, you're in the CIA or something. Get me Sid Haig. Okay, fine. Oh. So he says, I get it. You don't want to do any more stupid heavies. I've written the part of a judge for you, and I won't take no for an answer. Okay, boss, let's do this. And he didn't tell Pam, this was for Jackie Brown, he didn't tell Pam that he had cast me in that role. So when she came onto the set, and I'm standing there in the black robe, okay, she cracked up laughing. She literally hit the floor. Okay? And the thing was, I mean, we hadn't seen one another for 27 years, and it was like we had lunch together the day before. Just picked our relationship right back up. And the same thing happened, we've run into one another on occasion in the convention circuits, you know. And it's the same deal, you know, we're like brother and sister. I'd make a movie with her in a second. And as a matter of fact, she did it. She did a Denver Comic Con, because she lives just outside of Denver. And she did a Q&A, and there was a guy in the audience who said, you know, I'm a writer, and da da da. And if I were to write a television series starring you and Sid Haig, would you do it? She said, write it. Okay, so, yeah, hell yes.
So, looking back, you worked with Jack Hill a good bit. Now, as an actor, does that give you a level of comfortability that comes across on screen, a trust level that when he says something, you know exactly what he wants, or vice versa?
Yeah, when you work at that level, because I mean, I did his student film at UCLA, okay, which was a trip in itself, because he was doing his student film, and he was trying to cast it, and he couldn't find anybody to play the movie he liked. So, and his advisor, who was the head of the film department at UCLA, was Dorothy Harsner, who was the first female director in Hollywood. She was a good friend of a woman who was the ballet instructor at the Pasadena Playhouse, where I went to school. And so she called her and said, you know, we're having trouble casting this part. Do you have anybody that you could send over? She called me and she said, get your ass to UCLA right now and you better get the job. So I said, yeah, okay. Went over, met Jack, we got along really well together, and you know, we did this picture called The Host. Quentin Tarantino saw some clips of it and fell in love with it, went and found the lost footage, and there was one day that we worked where the sound was really screwed up. So he paid to get the sound fixed, and I had to recreate my voice from like 30 years ago. And the host is now the companion disc on Miramax's release of Switchblade Sisters. Yeah. But Jack and I have a great rapport. He was at my second wedding. And, so yeah, we have a really good relationship. A lot of trust.
So you were in Diamonds Forever. Talk about what it was like to work on a film like that, to be in a Bond film, which is everybody's dream.
Yeah. Sean Connery was so cool. Yeah, he's a fun guy, fun to be around. He hated the wig. And at the end of the day, when the first day, he said, okay, that's a wrap. He just ripped the wig off and threw it in the air. And if there happened to be a hairdresser under it, fine. If not, oh well. but yeah, he was just so much fun to be around. It was a great experience to do that film with that kind of thing.
Now, I just wanted to ask the audience a question, circle back to Spider Baby. How many people have seen Spider Baby? Raise your hand.
Okay, you're busy.
This is something that you have to do. Go to Amazon, buy it, whatever you have to do. We were talking earlier, Sid, why do you think this film keeps finding new legs?
You know, it's a mystery. I mean, we shot this film in 1964, and just recently, Arrow Films released the Blu-ray version. It's like every 5 years, we get a whole new fan base for this picture. It's weird, it's odd, it's creepy. It's the only horror film that I know of that doesn't have one drop of blood, but at the same time, from beginning to end, you're just totally creeped out.
So, one of the most famous scenes in The Corpses was the murder rat scene. Tell us about filming that, and is it true that you did that in one take?
It is true that I did that in one take, because that's my challenge. I mean, that's the way I challenge myself. And it was very cool to do that scene. There was some, well, let's face it, there was a lot of ad-libbing going on through that whole thing. The murder right scene was, I had a few surprises for Chris Hardwick and Reigns and all the rest of those guys. So it kept it like up. And that's what I tried to do through that whole film, was just keep the edge like really high. And sometimes you hit it, sometimes you don't, you know, but you gotta go for it.
Do you remember any of it?
Not a damn word.
you filmed an amazing scene, I think, in Corpses with the late Tom Tolles in the gasoline station. Talk about working with him, if you could, a little bit, and filming that scene.
You know, he and I connected, like, from the very first minute that we met. Okay? And over the course of years, we became really tight. And I was really devastated when he passed. But we had an intensity, I think, that we both latched onto. And that scene is a perfect example of what you should do as an actor when you're working, because the object for each one of us was to win, okay? And neither one of us was going to give up. And you only give up because the script says that ultimately you do. But, you know, he was able to keep that intensity going, and I just kept riding it with him. It was so cool to work with him.
So, on the Corpse DVD, something I just learned by mistake, if you let the opening credits play, it's you saying horrible things to the people watching the DVD. How did that, were those lines scripted, or did Rob just say, hey, you know what, you got this down, talk some shit?
Well, I got the script for that, which is, I don't know, 5 to 7 minutes long, something like that. I got the script of that after midnight, the night before we were supposed to shoot it. And I walked in the morning and I said, excuse the shit out of me, but you expect me to memorize all of this, like, overnight? And he goes, well, do you know the high points where you have to go? I said, well, yeah. He goes, well, and he handed me a jelly donut and a porno mag and said, go. So I just baited it.
Now, were you familiar with Rob before you worked with him? And how did that working relationship start?
That relationship started well before I knew it. Okay. What? He says. I was at his wedding reception, you know, with Sherry, and talking with his brother, Spider. And he said, this is so weird. I said, what, the wedding? He said, no, I'm standing here talking to you. I said, what the hell are you talking about? And when Rob and I were kids, we used to get up every Saturday morning and watch Jason and Starga Man, okay, which was a series that I had started. And he said, you kept creeping up in all of these films that Rob liked to watch. And at one point he said, you know, if I ever get to direct a movie, I want that guy in. And that's how that whole thing happened. I mean, I got a call from my agent. And at this point, I was like really pissed off because I was doing nothing but stupid movies and just pointing guns in people's faces, you know, blah, blah. And so my agent calls and I said, what? And he goes, okay, here's the deal. You go to this office on Wilshire Boulevard in Joliet, I'm impressed. And you sign a letter, non-disclosure, take the script home and read it, and if you like it, well, somebody's got a couple of synapses that are popping together. So I went home and I read it and I said, oh God, I've had so much fun with this. So I called the next day and I said, let's do it. And the first time I met Rob was in the wardrobe department while we were getting fittings for the show.
So we talked to Bill a little bit about the he was a shirt, so I thought we would ask you. The final scene of Forbes is whenever you pick up the girl. Are you aware of what happened prior to that? You know, are you aware of what she went through whenever you pick her up in the car there?
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay. I was aware. I felt that my character was aware of the fact that she kind of got away. Okay. And I was also aware of the fact that Bill was in the backseat. Okay. So it was no surprise to me when he popped up with the knife. And the whole deal of, you know, you look like you didn't see a doctor. And I got a doctor, I'm going to take you to, yeah, Dr. Satan, where she just escaped from. So I kind of knew that what was going on.
Now, in Corpses, you really didn't get to work with Bill a whole lot. But and Rejects, you guys shared the screen for the entire movie. Talk about a little bit about what it was like working with him.
It was really easy working with Bill because by that time we were friends, you know, and we kind of knew, you know, when you're close to somebody, you kind of know what they're thinking before they actually do something, okay? So we had that kind of relationship and we took the characters to the places that they went, kind of through instinct. He was, you know, really good to work with. So, the pleasure.
So, talk to us about the evolution of the character, kind of exploding from Corpses to Will Cutter from Devil's Rejects.
It was actually a matter of fleshing the character out. Okay, more because in House of a Thousand Corpses, you know, it was kind of cartoony and funny, while at the same time being scary. Okay, but with rejects, I can tell that now this is a much more deadly situation. And these sociopaths were really just out looking to kill as many people as they could. And I liked it. It was cool. There were, you know, some rewrites that went on, but I kept pretty much to the script. There was one scene, however, and Rob called everybody into the office because he wasn't really that happy with the way that he had written the scene. So he wanted to work with us, and it was the ice cream eating scene. And so we're working on the thing, and says, okay, so what are you going to say? You know, or you got any ideas? Let's just do it. Whatever comes out might be right, you know? And he said, yeah, okay. And so, you know, Bill starts with Bill, there you go, ice cream in your future. And I said, well, I think I'm going to give me some tutti fucking fruit. And, well, that stuck. I write that on more pictures than anything. And it just, you know, sometimes I just open my mouth and stuff falls out. It's just the way it is.
And Rejects, do you attribute fans rooting for the bad guys yourselves over the law enforcement to Rob's writing and directing or your portrayals?
Now you're putting me in the middle of all kinds of shit. It was a collaborative, you know, it was a collaborative effort. Well, I think we all liked the script better than we did House of a Thousand Corpses. Rob was a real fast learner and he was able to connect with the crew in a much more fashionable way, okay? Because he studied what he was doing in House of a Thousand Corpses, and the fact that, you know, he had to rely on the crew a lot. It was a, you know, great crew. But he picked up all of the elements of what it takes to make a picture, and he did that like really quickly because he's a smart guy, you know? And so we got a lot of confidence, a lot more confidence in him through the making of Devil's Rejects than you know, than we had before. I never doubted anybody, you know, because people would say, well, he's a musician, you know, and he's directing this picture. What do you think about that? I said, you know what? What you are as an artist in one area just carries over to whatever other artistic area you jump into. So I wasn't worried about him being a director at all, you know. And there's a certain amount of integrity that has to go along with any art form that you're working in. And just because he switched from being a musician to a director doesn't mean anything.
I have a question for you. This really applies to any movie, to be honest with you. But there's a scene in Rejects where you're willing to join on the couch, you smoke a joint. What do you smoke instead of weed? Like, what do they put in?
That was tobacco. Yeah. I had, because you can't smoke weed, it's against the law to smoke weed on camera. And in a lot of states. But oh well. But yeah, it was tobacco, and the thing is, I had quit smoking like 4 years before that, okay? And through the making of that scene, I had to light like a pack of cigarettes, and I just started getting dizzy. They had to take me outside, give me oxygen and everything else. So yeah, that was kind of nasty, but it was better, like, smoked a pound and a half of coke. I had to do that once in a film that I did called Commando Squad. Stressful situation. And I was a coke dealer, and I had this bag of coke, and I just ripped it open and stuck my face in it, all of, you know, Scarface. And I said, oh, wait a second, I don't mind doing this, but what actually is this? Okay. And the guy said, it's powdered B12. I said, oh, okay. Well, I had just been knocked into the water in the steam, and the water was like 41 degrees or something like that. Came up out of there, and I was instantly freezing to death. And I popped that bag open and snorted all of this B12, and I could feel the warmth coming up from the soles of my shoes up through the top of my head. I didn't sleep for like 3 days. So, if you want to stay up for a long time, just, you know, start some B12. And it's legal.
Talking about working with William Forsythe and how he was a method actor, pretty intense. Talk about the scene where he has you all tied up and sort of how that film worked.
Yeah, he and I actually worked a lot the same way, okay? So if there's antagonism going on between the characters, we're feeling that, okay? And I was starting to get really steamed because now I'm trapped in the chair, and, you know, I'm used to being the guy who takes shit from nobody. And he's going through all this weird stuff and whatever. At one point, he was supposed to start the scene by him throwing a bucket of water in our faces to wake us up as we were supposed to be unconscious. And I see a gas can, and the gas is supposed to come on later in the scene. And I said, wait a second, isn't this supposed to be, you know, a bucket of water? And he said, well, that doesn't work for me. I said, well, I don't give a fuck if it works for you or not. Okay, I mean, if we're going to get real, then have you never siphoned the gas in your life? Okay? Because if we're going to play this as gas, then I'm going to throw up. So, you know, is that okay with everybody? And so it was like, okay, yeah, we'll do the water and then the gas. And then we started doing the scenes, and he was going to hit me with the cattle prod. And I said, how many times are you going to hit me? He said, I don't know. I said, well, figure it out, because I got to react, okay? So we decided, okay, he's going to hit me 4 times or whatever. And then he went off script at one point and started rambling about all kinds of weird shit, okay? And, like, we should get together and start a rock group and go on tour. And I said, no, this ain't happening. So I said, shut your pile, you fudge packet motherfucker. In the corner here, cut. It was wrong. So obviously that scene didn't make it into the film, but, you know, that poor gentleman scene didn't make it into the film. But I mean, we were tense with one another. It didn't, you know, cause a problem. It's just two guys doing their thing, you know.
So there was a movie drink called Bill and Tom Club, which marries kind of two genres that you have been a part of in horror and western. So talk about acting in that film and kind of just feeling on set and what did you think of that?
That was really interesting. I really enjoyed working with David Arquette because it was basically, you know, he and I for that whole cycle. Killed me off the first 10 minutes. it was great fun working with him. It was intense because we were working on a place called Stevenson Ranch. It was like 110 degrees, and I had on the long john tops and a long sleeve shirt and a wool coat on top of that. So I was feeling kind of weak. And And then now he and I are climbing up and down stuff and doing all kinds of weird shit. And it was such a classic company because by the end of the day, I knew that that I would not be able to make it up. Okay, so I went to the first AD and I said, you know, I don't think I can make it all. He said, don't worry about it. Go change your clothes. And somebody got in my car with me, drove me home, and by the time we got there was a cab waiting to take him back to the set. So that shows that the people that were, you know, in charge of doing that film had a lot of class to be able to do that. I wish I had been able to work with Kurt Russell and all the rest of the guys, but that just didn't work out. But I had a good time working with David.
So a lot of directors like Rob Zombie, Tarantino, Rodriguez are, you know, really trying to make exploitation type films. You were such a huge part of that genre of film. What are some of your thoughts on some of the newer films? And do you think that there's a chance that the exploitation genre has a chance to become popular again?
I think the exploitation situation will happen again, because we go through cycles. You know, it's like we recycle ourselves every 20 years. I expect Dull Bottoms to come back like tomorrow. Okay. I see a future for exploitation. And I don't know what form it will take. It might be a situation of mirroring what's going on in our society today. You know? The fact that we have a tough time communicating with one another. It's just the whole digital age, electronic age and everything has got me scratching my head, because I see it all the time. Go to a restaurant with your family there, mother, father, three kids, and the kids are on their cell phones texting. Okay. And when I grew up, dinner time was the time that we talked about what happened during the day and, you know, what we were going to do and plans that we had. Vacation or whatever. It's like, I don't see families talking anymore. And I was in a restaurant in Portland, and three guys came in, obviously friends, because they were laughing and talking to each other. When they came in, they sat down and all three of them broke out their cell phones and started texting. What the hell is that? Okay. So, you know, they might do some exploitation of the digital age that we're in. I mean, there's a hotel in Tokyo that instead of waiters and waitresses and hotel staff of regular kind, it's all robots. And they have facial identification chips in these robots. And when the robot looks at you, it'll assess what nationality you are, and it will talk to you in that language, which is, excuse the language, fucking scary. and if they get it wrong, you just tell them what language that you speak in, and they instantly just start speaking in that language. And it's a little weird. Yeah. Now there's something. See, all those robots could all go bad. All right, wait a second. I gotta write this shit down. They could go bad and start taking everything over.
Skynet.
Yeah. So, any writers out there, get busy. Only I want to lead. Yeah. But I think exploitation will come back. It's like Rob brought back the horror films of the 70s.
Right, yeah, I think that Corpses and Rejects were definitely both exploitation films in a way.
Yeah, yeah.
So you were in Hatchet 3 as well, and just crushed it in your role the entire time. Talk about did you do a lot of ad-lib? Because I know that's kind of a thing that we see a lot of you do. What was it? Did you do a lot of off-script for that?
I think I did a little. Of course, I always do a little. and that's just the way I am. But I had so much fun doing that was crazy. And but at the same time, very spooky, because the guy that played the sheriff, Robert Doheny Jr., okay, I worked with his father 30 years before in coffee.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. He was the guy that the King George, the pimp, okay? And I put a noose around his neck and slammed the end of the rope through the door of the car, drove it through the city. Yeah, that was his son. And he walked and talked and looked exactly like his father. And it was so creepy. He was like, too much overload. Yeah.
The years of acting and all the accomplishments that you've done in Hollywood, does it bother you at all that some people only know you as Captain Spaulding, or do you find it maybe a little gratifying that they might go back and look at your earlier works?
I've found over the years that people do go back and say, you know, I wonder what this guy did, because when House of 1000 Corpses came out, everybody thought that was my first job. Okay? And it's like, you know, if it didn't happen, anything that happened before 1982 didn't happen. It just didn't exist, you know. But people have started going back and looking at films that I had done previously and some of the old television shows and stuff like that. So that makes me feel good.
So I know this is a hard question to answer, but you've just been in so many films, and then we're doing this panel, your legacy panel. Is there something that sticks out to you as maybe the biggest challenge, not so much your favorite, but the most rewarding role you have in?
I've been fortunate, really fortunate, to be able to say that I've been a working actor for 54 years, okay? And that I've worked with some of the most amazing people around. There's not many people that can say that they worked with Lon Chaney Jr. As a matter of fact, I'm probably the only living person on this planet today that can say that his first co-starring role was with Lon Chaney Jr. Okay. But besides Lon, there was people like Bob Hope. I did Bob Hope show two or three times. Lucille Ball, I worked with her. Annie Thomas, Red Skelton, Omar Sharif. And that was wild. I did a film with him called Che, which was basically chronicle of Che Guevara when he went to Bolivia to establish Bolivia as a communist country. And I played the leader of the Bolivian Communist Party. And at the end of the film, we have this confrontation because Jay's asthma really started kicking in and he started getting crazier and crazier. And, you know, he was known as Castro's executioner, okay? And anybody he didn't like just got shot. And so he started really mistreating the Bolivian people. Even though what he's preaching, you know, love and all the rest of that stuff. And so we had this confrontation. And the director, Richard Fleischer, who just a year before won an Academy Award for Dr. Doolittle, the Rex Harrison one. set up the scene with Sharif in his hammock, kind of nursing his asthma along. With me standing up on a rock, you know, like 20 feet away and doing the scene, and it just felt so weird. And Sharif noticed that there was something going on inside my melon that, you know, wasn't right. And he said, Sid, come here. So I went over to him and he said, what's wrong? I said, and he goes, don't try to bullshit me. What's wrong? And so I gave him my feelings that, you know, I think this thing should start much more intimately and then escalate into the fight. And he thought about it a second and he said, Richard, and he called Fleischer over and he said, I have an idea, knowing that Richard Fleischer's not going to listen to me. He's going to listen to Omar Sharif. And Omar said, you know, I think this thing should be a little more intimate, started more intimately, and then escalate from there. And Fleischer thought about it a second. And this is a testimony to him being so flexible. You know, he said, well, you learn something every day. New setup. And we started the thing like 3 or 4 feet away from one another. And it escalated into a big fight. And you know, went on with the thing. He didn't have to do that. You know, he was the star of the film. I mean, Omar Sharif was making millions of dollars for every picture. You know, and just made all these amazing Dr. Zhivago when he was in Lawrence of Arabia and all the rest of these films. So I really felt honored that he would even think about asking me, you know, how what I felt about that scene. That was so cool, and stuff like that. I think that's the thing that hooks you in when you have experiences like that. You know, I went on an audition for. This is an example of never say never, because I always said, well, I'll never do a soap opera. And I got asked to go audition for an episode of Mary Hartman, Mary Hartman. Anybody ever see that show? Okay. So I went and did the thing and got the part, and Harry Dean Stanton and I basically harassed the hell out of Mary Kay Place. And that episode aired New Year's Eve. Yeah, great. So about a week later, I get a call, and they wanted to know if I would like to do another one because, you know, it looked like I had a good time, and they had a good time with me. 126 episodes later, they killed me. Never say never. And I was so crazy doing that role that they never knew what to expect. And the director, Jim Drake, would never say cut at the end of the scene, particularly if Dabney Coleman and I were doing a scene together, okay? Just to see what we would do. So at one point in the story, Guy enters in and he's like my boss, and we are working for the GGG, the Glorious Guardians of Good, get the reference, okay? So we're doing this scene, and he says, you know, when we take over the White House, what are you going to do? And playing this dumbass redneck, I said, come on, get me a copy of Hustler magazine and just hang out in the tub all day. And he said, is that all you want out of life? And the thing is supposed to end with me with this quizzical look on my face, like, is there anything else? And the word cut never came. And I said, well, would like to have a baby gorilla. Okay. Still nothing. A little gold chain. Nope. I'd call him Max and teach him how to make Mai Tais. Okay. Finally, the director comes on, and you can hear the laughter in the control room. Okay. And he's like, cut, you crazy son of a bitch. So, and that, you know, they kept that. It aired. So, they finally killed me off in it. And that show, you never knew when you were going to die until you got the script that morning. Because what we would do, we'd come in at 8 o'clock in the morning, we'd get a script for that day, and then we'd block it, and set the blocking, and then send us off to learn the dialogue, and then come back at 5 or 6 o'clock and shoot it. And there was never a take two. If you got in trouble, you just worked it out. Okay. And so you never knew until you read the script. You know? Yeah, one day I hear this, God damn it! Okay, somebody just got killed. And I just read about it. Okay, so that's the way things go. So I knew at some point that was going to happen with me. And I never wanted to end the show because they were going to, you know, close the show down because they were having problems with one of the stars. And I said, don't close the show. We have to because we can't work with her anymore. I said, look, here's the deal. She goes to pick up her daughter from dance class. She gets in a terrible accident. The plastic surgeon is a drunk and gets the pictures mixed up. You take the bandage off, it's a new actress. Okay? And he went, okay, you are crazy. You're going to certify a whole son of a bitch. Okay? So they decide they're going to end with him. So they kill me off, and the producers come down, and they, you know, said, God, it's been a great run, and we've had a great time together, and he says, it's not over. I said, what do you mean it's not over? We just killed you. I said, yeah, I know, but it's not over. I said, what else is there? I said, we have to come back as our wives to claim the bodies, okay? And they looked at one another, and they looked at the wardrobe mistress, and I said, go all Western costume, get two dresses over here tomorrow morning. Okay, so we came back as our wives to claim the bodies. And they said, okay, that's it. I said, no, it's not it. It's what? I said, I want to direct this damn thing, okay? So they went to Jim Drake and they said, do you mind apprenticing to Sid as a director as we close this show down? And he said, no, not at all. I was surprised. And so I would get the script the night before, go do the breakdown on it, get all the shots lined up and everything. And the last couple of weeks of production, I directed all the scenes with like two or three people, and then he directed all the big, bigger scenes. And that was very cool. I just loved the openness of them, you know, thinking that would be a good idea. So it was cool.
So one final question to end this panel. Not in the Hollywood side of things, but you actually worked with some PTSD. Patients. If you could tell us a little bit about that and your work with that, just so we know what you contributed to the veterans.
When I decided that if Hollywood could figure out that I could do something more than just point a gun in somebody's face, I was just going to back away until I got smart. And I had to figure out something to do for a living. And I'd always done a lot of home study in psychology so I could better create a character. So I started searching around, and I knew damn well that I couldn't afford to go back to college and become a psychiatrist, because that's going to take me 10 years, okay? And I had a family to support. So I started searching around. I found a place called the Hypnosis Motivation Institute. And it was the College of Therapy. Cool. So I sent away the letter for the brochure and stuff and made an appointment and went in and took a test because they wanted to make sure that you're not crazy before they, you know, let you play around in somebody's mind. And so I went through that situation. It was very interesting. And found out almost to a person that we were all there basically to help ourselves. Okay? Never realized that until we really got into it. And so that was an amazing situation. And hypnotherapy, as a therapist, you are communicating directly with your client's subconscious mind. And that's a big responsibility. And when people talk about going to psychiatrists, to hypnotherapists, I say, you know, make sure that the person has had at least 300 hours of education before they became certified. Because they hand out certifications like 24 hours. I mean, the first day of class, we learn how to hypnotize. Okay? It's what you do, what you get there. And I was reading in the paper where almost daily there were literally thousands of veterans committing suicide because of PTSD. And so I called college and I said, you know, we've got to come up with a program to help these guys out. I mean, they're putting their asses on the line for this country, and then the country is just like going, oh well, and not doing anything to help the veterans out. So came up with a program, and it's basically getting rid of those images in the mind. And there's various ways of doing that, and it's all individual. You have to kind of figure out where your client's head is and what it is that that person has to deal with, and then work from that basis to try to erase those things from their memory. And it's a rewarding situation. Whether you're working with somebody with PTSD or somebody who's been a smoker all their life and want to quit but just don't know how. And I've done sessions at conventions with people and for like an hour and a half in their hotel room. And it's been like my last one that I did. It's been over a year, and that person hasn't picked up the cigarette since. So being able to help people like that just makes me feel good that, I can in some way contribute to somebody else's benefit.
Well, thanks for that, Sid, and thank you for what an illustrious career, and lots more to come. Everybody, give it up for Sid HAIG.